And now, ladies and gentlemen, here he is, the real Tony D, Tony D'Angelo.
Well, hi, Team Asabis. It's Tony D'Angelo. It is December 28th, Ada Domini, in the year of our Lord, 3 p.m. So happy to have you here on the normal Thursday broadcast of 30 with Tony on Twitter at 3. It's very easy to follow. I mean, they like to throw this X thing in here, but, you know, I kind of like Twitter. I call it Twitter X. So happy to have you. So grateful for you. Hope you all had a Merry Christmas. And very grateful to our music contributors. We're really starting to step up the music. We're getting a lot of compliments about that. And for that, I'm grateful. It's a journey for me, like many things are. Or it's a struggle for me, like just about everything is. But we're going to look at something today that I think is critical for us to know in 2024. Who's the real enemy? And I'm talking in natural terms. I'm not talking about the presence of Satan or evil spirits, but I'm talking in natural terms. I'm going to submit unto you, it's not the Democrats, it's not the Republicans, it's not the blacks, the whites, the three-fingered Hungarians, the cats, the dogs, the frogs, or the hogs, but it's going to be something that really until this morning I've never considered, and we're going to be coming back with that right after this. Thanks, Kemosabes. Thank you for being here. And I want to thank each and every one of you who have encouraged me, who have shared the broadcast, who have commented on it. And for everybody who's watching, either on its first, we have the live airing, or on the replay, if you will. And I'm very grateful to you. And I'm very grateful to God for you. And I have come to the conclusion that I'm learning as I go, that normally three types of people watch this broadcast. Those that like and encourage and follow and like the shows and, you know, might like me. I might caution you about that. Those that absolutely hate me and hate the topics which are discussed, you know, they're doing opposition research or whatever. I don't know. Maybe they laugh at the jokes at the end. You know, I welcome them too. And then I think we've got some people that are undecided or they've been told by friends, this is a good place to go and spend, 30, 45 minutes to knock around. I welcome you all. I'm grateful for you all. And this is a building process. We've started with a few viewers, and the Christmas show had a ton of viewers. So, welcome you back if you're back here for the first time. All that said, I've been doing some contemplation at the close of 2023. And, I think we all do. We see another year, we see another year past. We think of the people we've lost during the year. During Christmas, we think of the people that we lost in our lives prior to that. And, we think about, how are we going to make it better? How are we going to make it different? What are we going to do to change things? And what can we do to really, frankly, know more about what we need to do in order to do what's right and to protect ourselves from harm and to help others? Now, when I thought of that, what am I going to do this year? A very good friend yesterday called up and we were talking, and she said to me, addressing me, "What do you have to do, Tony, to get people to see what's actually taking place?" Most people listening or watching, many times just shrug their shoulders and say, "Gee, that's a hoot," or probably don't care, or "What's the next episode of whatever the new hot show is?" And I don't know. I don't follow those things much anymore. And the only thing that I said to her is, "Look, my Savior, Jesus Christ, believed in the value of repetition. He kept saying to the apostles, 'Again, I say to you, again, I say to you.'" In other words, get it, get it. A couple of times you might have been thinking, "You stupid dolt, why aren't you getting it?" Jesus was not a saint. He was tempted in all points like we are. But all of that said, and a couple of times he justifiably lost his temper. But which is why I love and relate to Jesus, just one of the reasons I do. But with that said, the only thing that my mission right now is to bring it. And my belief is by bringing it, you'll see it, you'll do something, and so will others. Now, if you choose not to do anything, if you think everything's great and hunky-dory and there's nothing for you to do and I'm just some nut, venting his spleen twice a week, that's okay. That is your right to do that. But do not expect me to come and bail you out on the day when there's nothing there for you, because those people who were telling you the truth have been lying to you all along. But that all said, when you look at the world today, you look at the border, which is a total and extreme joke. I mean, there's no other country in the world where you can just walk in and just wave, and everybody in the White House appears to be either high or out to lunch, or they don't care. You look at what's happening in the cities. I mean, I can't believe personally what's happening in places like New York and Los Angeles. In my young adulthood, these were the two places where you did not screw up, regardless of what happened. I mean, the LA cops, way back when, were very well known for using their hands and using their fists and using their clubs. And the idea was you were to stay out of the way. I'm not saying I endorse that, but they did have less crime then. I mean, we've come from that to what we've got now, which is just insane. New York, I mean, I look at a mayor who honestly looks like a substitute teacher who's entirely lost control of his class and with no idea as to what's going to happen next. When people start to protest on the highway, on the freeway, in the street, you've completely lost society. You've completely disregarded and devalued every single person who may need that street for work, for business, for family, for childcare, or for something to do. This is just, young girls are getting stabbed in Grand Central. I mean, Grand Central Station, railway station. It's absolutely unbelievable. So I wonder, it's like, where do we go? You look at the political mix, mass, and I mean, we're probably going to end up with the same contestants that we did in 2020. It would have taken 5 minutes to decide if this is what we're going to do. And it's absolutely, I mean, I rail a lot of the time. I believe, albeit justifiably, on the Lee Elsie show in here, of these politicians that think they are the source and savior and director of everything else. We're going to get to that in a moment. But it's like you just shake your head and say, how stupid can people be? And that's really what I want to talk to you about. I, like many, will have hope that 2024 will be a better year than 2023, that we could get to some kind of sanity in this country, for things to work normally again, for children to be educated, for cities to be safe, for transportation to actually be transportation and not some political exercise and gaga futility and protest and everything else. But in order to do that, I'm beginning to realize something. You have to fight against the enemy. Now, the enemy, and this may sound strange coming from me, even though I am a, political independent. Many times I say I'm a political agnostic. I'm not really terribly impressed with a lot of what I see things. I see things in certain people that I like. For example, I think Vivek Ramaswamy's ideas of dealing with the administrative state in the United States government, I think, are flat out brilliant. Is he the total solution to everything? I can't say. In some ways, I don't think so. But there's things like that. You see flashes, but by and large, across the board, you see political stupidity. And that's what I wanted to tell you about. The real enemy is not the Connecticut Democrat Party. The real enemy is not the National Democrat Party. Don't turn me off just yet. The real enemy is stupid people. Now, you say to yourself, look at a man like Joe Biden, if you want to call him a man. Pick any one of the Connecticut state senators in the Democrat Party, a little better in the Republican Party, some, having some, having substance. But let's look at that. Can any of these people make you do anything? Do they have the physical power? Do they have the control? Are you some sort of battery-operated robot that they can kind of steer around like these little toys that I had as a kid? Robot Commando, the missiles would come out of his head. Coolest thing in the world. I wouldn't get him here now. I drive the animals nuts. Maybe I'll get it. I don't know. But that all kind of being as it is, these people in political positions, in order to espouse their whatever it is, they need stupid people to carry out the mission. I mean, look at a what they call pro-Palestinian protests. I mean, those people there, I mean, you listen to what some of them are saying. They have no idea what the heck they're doing, but they are made to be pawns to be directed by somebody who's stupider than, than you may think, but has an agenda and gets them to do it. And that's where you have the beatings and the damage and something like that. I'm watching something the other night, and this is where I think you got to go to Twitter and get your news. There was the protests in Christmas Day in New York City, and there was some idiot thought it was good to attack a police officer. And I mean, why the police in New York take what they do these days is absolutely positively beyond me. I mean, to me, that's not the New York City police. But the other police officers rightfully came to this man's aid. Now, when this is happening, there's a young girl who jumps on the pile. She's a young lady of color. She gets pushed off. She's yelling and screaming, yelling all kinds of things. They're not even prosecuting her. And then there is a young black man pointing at the police officers, yelling, Jew. I mean, believe me, none of these guys look Jewish. You know, they looked either very Italian to me, or they were people of color, or they were Hispanic. I mean, it's just, my point is that you need a stupid person to carry out the deed. And that's really where the danger is. You know, think of it. Excuse me. Think of it. If you've watched couples through the years, you know, married couples, relationships, or things like that, many times a couple, I'm being, you know, Father Tony here telling you about relationships. Many times a couple collapses because one of the two parties is stupid. They don't understand time. They don't understand money. They don't understand logistics. They don't understand what to value as opposed to what not to value. And the other person, and in many cases, the family, suffers because of that. Now, stupidity and education are not oftentimes rising on the same level. You can be very educated, but highly stupid, and vice versa. You can have little formal education, but be very bright and be very innately bright. I have friends like that. I have clients like that. They maybe got as far as high school. Excuse me, some didn't. But they're innately bright and they know what they have to do and they apply themselves to the task at hand. Now, I'd like to share something with you. And I'm going to make a statement. It's not the political parties that are your greatest enemy going into 2024. It is the stupid people. I'm going to tell it the way it is. I mean, there's a lot of stupid politicians. I get that. But the politician cannot exercise stupid without minions that are stupider and can be led by the politicians. I'm telling you the way it is. So bear with me for just a second. Just going to get a little sip of tea. Oh, what a world it would be if we didn't have tea. And I'm going to go over to here, if I may. And let me just see here. I'm going to share the screen. And we're going to go over. Someone had shared this with me earlier. I was not familiar with this gentleman, but I'm going to look more into him. I submit to many people that the contributions of the deceased are many times far better than what you're going to get from the modern day contributions of the living. Take that any way you want. I can take it any number of ways. But this person here, Dietrich Bonhoeffer, if I'm pronouncing that correctly, was a German Lutheran pastor, theologian, and he was an anti-Nazi dissident. And he was actually highly critical. I'm condensing this man's wonderful life work into a nutshell. He was highly critical of the Nazi regime going way back when. You got to remember something. Hitler in the early 30s, up until about maybe up until the time he actually went into Poland, was considered to be somebody who you could deal with positively. Sounds a lot like our modern day politicians. You know, well, we could be bipartisan. We can work things out. You know, I've appealed to this man's sense of reason. Where really the person doing the negotiating has no sense whatsoever that this person is kind of putting them on and putting a dog on and has no idea whatsoever to get to any sort of middle ground. They'll just humor this person in order to get them to where they want to go. But Bonhoeffer came out very early, back when, you know, Joe Kennedy, the father of John and Robert Kennedy, was the ambassador to Great Britain. And he was trying to tell Franklin Delano Roosevelt that we could do something economically with Hitler. And Neville Chamberlain, read about him, 1938, he was the prime minister of Great Britain, flew to Germany and thought he worked out a peace treaty with Hitler. A peace in our time. You can look at it on the internet or YouTube or something like that. And, you know, we know where that all went. But that all said, Bonhoeffer came out early and said, hey, this guy's bad egg. This guy's trouble. You know, you've got to deal with him. And not only that, the thing that Bonhoeffer was saying was where Hitler was dangerous, where Biden is dangerous. Some of you will say where Bob Duff is dangerous is they get people to do their bidding for them. And the people essentially turn into irrational seas, for lack of a better term. And they get elected and they lay in the road and they dance on the freeway and they screw up your life and they claim for more welfare and all to your benefit. But the damage is essentially done by stupid people. And Bonhoeffer was imprisoned by the Nazis. And he actually came to that conclusion. He said, and I maybe not quoting exactly, the real damage is not done by the evil, because you can protect yourself against the evil. I can lock my door. I can lock my gate. I can buy a gun. I can buy an attack dog. You know, I can stop. I can steer away from things that are bad. I'm able to protect against the evil much better than I am to protect against the stupid, because the stupid can infiltrate. They can be in your family. They can be in your town. If you've never had stupid in-laws, God bless you. I cannot say that I have come to that same place in my life. And the damage people like that can do when they are close to you. But that all said, the real damage comes from the stupid. And I'm going to take this to just another share over here. There's a very good video on this on the internet. I had actually posted it the other day, and it's a 6-minute cartoon video that explains it. But Bonhoeffer, when he was locked up in the Nazi prison camp, had a revelation. And he said, you know, the theory of stupidity is that we have more to fear from stupid people than evil ones. When we know something or someone is evil, we can take steps to fight it. With stupidity, it's much more difficult. Dietrich Bonhoeffer argues that stupidity is worse than evil because stupidity can be manipulated and used by evil. Sound familiar? He also argues that stupidity tends to go hand in hand with acquiring power. That is, being in power means we surrender our individual critical faculties. Think about that. Think about all the times you voted for somebody thinking they were going to be on the beam. They got there and they started to be entirely stupid and go the other way. I was mentioning the other day, Michael Bloomberg, probably his first term as a mayor in New York, he out-Giulianied Rudy Giuliani. He was a logistical marvel. The streets were safe. He moved things along. He encouraged business. But when his liberal following started to get on him about stop and frisk and broken windows, he completely did a 180 and got away from all that and does not want you to remember that he did any of that, because he saw his multi-million, billion, I don't know, dollar empire collapsing. And so Michael followed the way of the buck rather than the way of what's correct. And we have the New York we have today after, you know, contributions from some buttes like Bill de Blasio. This is funny. There's an internet adage that says debating. I want to give credit here to the author of this article. This is called Big Think. And it was written in January 26th of 2023. There's an internet adage that goes, debating an idiot is like trying to play chess with a pigeon. It knocks the pieces over, craps on the board, and flies back to claim victory. And it's funny and astute. And that's exactly what it's like arguing with an idiot. And we laugh it off. And stupidity, though, going over here, I'm just going to highlight if I can grab my mouse, has its dark side. Actually, not over there. I want to go over to here. For theologian and philosopher Dietrich Bonhoeffer, the stupid person is often more dangerous than the evil one. And going to scroll down a little bit. Talks about the villains in comics. We know how to deal with the villain. But let's get to the meat of the matter. Stupidity, though, is a different problem altogether. I'm not doing so hot with the mouse today, am I? We cannot so easily fight stupidity for two reasons. First, we are collectively much more tolerant of it. Unlike evil, stupidity is not a vice most of us take seriously. We do not lambaste others for ignorance. We do not scream down people for not knowing things. Second, the stupid person is a slippery opponent. They will not be beaten by debate or open to reason. What's more, when the stupid person has their back against the wall, when they're confronted with facts that cannot be refuted, they snap and lash out. Bonhoeffer puts it like this. I'm just going to scroll down a little bit. And this is in the words of Bonhoeffer. And let me highlight this for you. Neither protest nor the use of force accomplish anything. Here, reasons fall on deaf ears. Facts that contradicts one's prejudgment simply need not be believed. In such moments, the stupid person even becomes critical. And when facts are irrefutable, how many times are facts irrefutable? When you deal in the land with the Democrats and the land of King Governor Ned Lamont the Unaccountable, they're just pushed aside as inconsequential, as incidental. In all this, the stupid person, in contrast to the malicious one, is utterly self-satisfied and, being easily irritated, becomes dangerous by going on the attack. Well, most of them I know kind of run and hide. And he goes on in this article to mention, with great power comes great stupidity. Stupidity, like evil, is no threat as long as it hasn't got power. We laugh at things when they are harmless, such as my brother's ignorance of reindeer. They won't cause any pain, therefore it's funny. People thought Hitler was funny. They thought the man with the beady eyes and the mustache was funny, right? I don't need to tell you the rest of that story. The problem with stupidity, though, I'm going to highlight this, bear with me just a second, is often goes hand in hand with power. Bonhoeffer writes, upon closer observation, it becomes apparent that every strong upsurge of power in the public sphere, be it of a political or religious nature, infects a large part of humankind, which stupidity. This works in two ways. We'll read down a little bit. The first is that, actually, sorry, thank you for making the screen jump. I'm going to get you back here, I promise. Actually, I'm going to do it this way. I think technology certainly is a mixed blessing. The first, that stupidity does not disbar you from holding office or authority. History and politics are swimming with examples of when the stupid have risen to the top and when the smart are excluded or killed. Sound familiar? Second, the nature of power requires that people surrender certain faculties necessary for intelligent thought, faculties like independence, critical thinking, and reflection. In other words, Bonhoeffer came to the realization when he was in prison that if you get into politics, many times you've got to check your brain at the door. And how many times have we felt that? How many times have I said that? How many times, have I been on the radio show or have I been here saying, are these people thinking? Do they see anything? Do they read anything? And Bonhoeffer's saying they don't. And I mean, to me, this is an immediate revelation. And it's just something that sets me free in a lot of ways. Bonhoeffer's argument, read down this a little bit, I think this is a gem, is the more someone becomes part of the establishment, the less of an individual they become. A charismatic, exciting outsider, bursting with intelligence and sensible policies, becomes imbecilic the moment he takes office. It's as if slogans, catchwords, and the like have taken possession of him. Also, I think, lobbyists and bribing and all kinds of free things. He's under a spell, blinded, misused, and abused in his very being. Now, I might not be as cynical as Bonhoeffer. I think what happens with a lot of these people is they kowtow to the majority view of stupidity because they like the cushy gig and they want to be reelected. But I'm just going to leave you with this one thing. We can go on and on about how stupidity is dangerous. Bonhoeffer's argument then is that stupidity should be viewed as worse than evil. I'm with you, man. Stupidity has far greater potential to damage our lives. More harm is done by one powerful idiot than a gang of Machiavellian schemers. We know when there's evil and we can deny its power. When the corrupt, oppressive, and sadistic We know where we stand. You know how to take a stand. But stupidity is harder to weed out. I'm going to highlight this because I think it's meaningful. That's why it's a dangerous weapon, because evil people find it hard to take power. They need stupid people to do their work. Like sheep in a field, a stupid person can be guided, steered, and manipulated to do any number of things. Evil is a puppet master and loves nothing so much as the mindless puppets who enable it, be they the general public or in the corridors of power. Now I'm going to stop this share, if I may. And it dawns on me. The real evil is not the political system, but the stupid people enabling the political system. Now, you can buy these people off all kinds of ways. You know, you can throw them a program. You could give them something like, you know, free housing for all, or we need housing, or, you know, history is not what history is, and we've got to teach it another way. And of course, you do that by handing out goodies. Different goodies, jobs. Of course, if you're in Connecticut, everything is solved with politics or a program. It's never solved with policy. Connecticut is so bereft of policy, it is absolutely positively unbelievable. We've never had political figures that could really, in my estimation, probably in either side of the aisle, have ever really dealt in serious policy. It's always been some, you know, kind of throw money thing, or this is good because I said it was good, but they need enablers. And I think if I'm going to leave you with the grace of God for one thing going into 2024, don't fear, I'm going to disagree with Bonhoeffer, don't fear the stupid people, but call their stupidity to them. And when they're going to start with all this stupid nonsense and this and that, whatever the case may be, convince them of their own stupidity to the point where they become inert and inoperative, because that's really the enemy. I mean, they can go ahead and they can plan whatever they want to do in an office, but they need these other people to carry it out. And when you stop the stupidity, you cause great things to happen. Now, there's a number of different things where Bonhoeffer, I'm sure, was like, you can't stop the stupidity. I believe you can. You can idiot-proof things. Believe it or not, sometimes you'll idiot-proof things to the 19th degree, and somebody will come with the 20th, 21st, and 22nd. Been there, done that, it's happened. There's nothing worse in the world than a stupid family member, a stupid business partner, a stupid, you know, estate beneficiary, in many cases, a stupid parent or a stupid child. I'm calling it the way it is. But that's where the time and the money and the frustration and the angst and many times the death occurs, all because of it. I know people very close to me who were killed by their own family members, but the family members thought they were doing the right thing. And that's some of these stories I'm not quite ready to share yet. But it's absolutely positively true. So when you see stupid, say stupid. Maybe that's a phrase. And stop stupid from hurting you. And when you start to see things, rather than trying to appeal to some greater notion or why this doesn't work from a policy, they don't care about that. They'll indulge you in that in order to get those things. Call it as stupid and deal with it as stupid. And let's be efficient in 2024. And let's stop. Or we said a couple of weeks ago, stop the stupid. This is where we have to stop the stupid. And I think in many ways, we have to stop the stupid. It's absolutely unbelievable. The stupidity we're seeing today is beyond any sort of rational terms. We have people with no convictions. We have people with no sense. We have people with no mind. And a lot of these people have gotten into power. And I mean, they're entirely irrational. I could drive people my age nuts by mentioning Donald Trump. They won't deal with it. You know, they may have to go to the hospital. Their hearts are beating so hard. I mean, Donald Trump's not going to hurt them. Donald Trump doesn't even know them. Not for nothing. Donald Trump probably doesn't even care about them. You know, they're not his people. But that all being as it is, it's just it amazes me. But I'm going to meditate on that this year. I'd like for you to do so as well, because we can do a whole lot of good in this world. We can eliminate all of the stupid in our lives and just get down to the real business of what is business. One of my good pals on Twitter, Mark from West Hartford, shared with me, if this was Wednesday morning, about bus riders. Do you talk about stupid? Bus riders want to have a union. A union of bus riders, of people riding the bus. Now, of course, you've got people in Connecticut when they hear the word union, the Julie Kushners of the world, Senator Julie Kushner, say, well, let's unionize them. Let's give them benefits. When they strike and they don't feel like riding the bus, we're going to give them strikers' benefits, right? I mean, this is the whole thing. In a name policy like that, if something should occur, you need the stupid people to carry it out. I used to say that for years, and people call me all kinds of names. I'll tell you, I don't care anymore. Call me whatever name you want. Stupid is devastating. And I've seen it for too many years. I've seen the damage. But if there's one thing I think we can do as a New Year's resolution, let's get rid of the stupid. Let's stop the stupid from happening wherever we can. And I think if we do that and we work and we pray and we do what's right and we keep good things before us, we'll have a much better end of 24 than we did at a beginning of 24. Pray, believe, work, change things, and that's what's going to make the difference. Not getting involved in all the political mess, but when something's stupid, let's fix it before it causes any more damage. Let's start there. It's Tony D'Angelo here on 30 with Tony. We are cooking, baby. Last show of the year. Thank you very much. We'll be right back right after this.
And the sign said, long-haired freaky people need not apply. So I took my hair up under my hat and I went in to ask him why. Gives you the right to put up a fence to keep me out or to keep Mother Nature in. If God was here, he'd tell you to your face, man, you're some kind of sinner.
Sign, sign, everywhere a sign, blocking out the scenery, breaking my mind. Do this, don't do that, can't you read?
Well, thanks, Kemosabes. Thanks for staying with us. I was thinking about the divorce proceeding happened very recently in Detroit, where a very young boy was in the judge's chambers with the very kindly old judge. And the judge said to the young boy, son, I'm sorry, your parents can no longer live together. You've got to make a decision as to which one you want to live with. I'm very sorry about that. It's always my best wish in this court that people will find a way to hold families together, but in this case, it doesn't look like it's going to happen. So the judge said, would you want to live with your father? And the kid said, no, 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 he beats me. Okay, well, the other choice is your mother. No, 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 she beats me too. And the poor judge is scratching his head, says, look, I don't want to send you to the social system of the state of Michigan. Who do you want to live with? And the kid says, the Detroit Pistons. So, well, why the Detroit Pistons? Because they never beat anybody. That's been used for the New York Mets, the Chicago Cubs, Philadelphia Phillies when they were bad anyway. I'll try to do better next time. It's Tony D'Angelo here on 30 with Tony. Thank you. God bless you. Have a wonderful New Year's Eve, New Year's Day, and a great 2024. And pray. God bless us all in this world. We'll see you, to be trite, next year on 30 with Tony. Bye, Kemosabes.
Single word, but you know you'll break my heart when I want you close.